dumb.
Hey, good morning.
Good morning.
It is great to be here in Potomac Valley. It's up 95. And so excited to be here. Thank you, Will and Tasha, for inviting us and having us come up. And gotta make sure I'm all set here. Awesome. Thanks, Ian. Let's pray before we do anything else. Father God, thank you so much for this time. It is great to be here in Potomac Valley. And so many familiar faces that I see and people that I've known for even decades, God. And just great to be in the kingdom of God. And God, we are so grateful for the church that you died for, that you created, and that we all can be a part of it. And really, what bonds us together more than anything else is the blood of Jesus. And God, I'm so grateful for that. I do pray for the message today, God. The cross is such a broad topic to preach on, and there's so many aspects. And Father, I pray that our hearts will be moved and touched in an incredible way, God. I pray that for those that may have never heard this message, God, to be pierced. I pray for those who have heard this message over and over, and even every Sunday, God, I pray that our hearts will be cut once again, and that the cross can always be before us. God, I thank you so much. Thank you for your spirit and even Jesus dying so that he will come and guide us and direct us and empower us. God, it is so exciting to be a Christian. God, thank you so much for what you've allowed us to be a part of and even giving us the ability to repent. God, we do love you and pray for you to really step out in front. Remove me from the pulpit even at this time. So Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So it is great to be here. Can I remove?
Yes, you can.
How'd y'all want me to do a little singing or something? That would not be good for y'all. It is great to be here. I want you guys to know you have got something great.
That's right.
Here in Potomac Valley.
Come on, Pova.
I tell you, as we rode up, I couldn't help but see Potomac Valley signs everywhere. I said, I know exactly where we're going now. But just to see the family, the unity, the team, I thought, man, who got up and put those things out that early in the morning?
That's right.
Logan Summit!
Summit!
I always wanted to do that. But to see Logan and Ashley here leading in a great way as well, super inspiring. Your elders, amen. To have them, that is awesome. I just gotta lift up Will and Tasha. And if you guys don't, I know you know.
Yeah.
But we want to tell you again what sweet gems you have in these guys.
Amen.
And to really. Really appreciate, man, the awesome convictions, the love that they have. Man, them really wanting to be servants for God. It's beautiful. And you guys have got to see, oh man, we have got. I know you do know. But I just want to remind you how sweet that is.
Yeah.
And if you want to make sure that they stay here, you just got to keep quiet. Sometimes just say, hey, don't let everybody know how awesome it is in the Amen. People start coming and scouting and looking. And I'm not one of those people, by the way. But it is great to be here today. I'm going to preach about the cross.
Come on, Tony.
And this is my family.
Woo!
Nice.
See, yes, we're looking kind of dark there. That was nice. It looks better on the computer. Helper and her and warrior, Our two boys, Zion and Bryce, 18. Man, my son is, my oldest is 18. Wow. High school this year. That's exciting. And my 14-year-old is entering high school this year as well, so, or next year as well. So that's encouraging. So just wanted to give some introductions to that, get that out of the way. Amen. And back to the cross. A great message. The message of the cross. What does the cross mean to you? I don't think it's something that we always think about. Communion is definitely a time that someone actually steers us in that direction that we should be thinking about the cross. But the cross in this day and age would have been something that they saw all the time, just on everyday roads. All right. As they saw people dying. And that message meant something. Something struck their hearts at that time, every time they saw a cross. And I think the same thing should happen for us in this day and age. Yeah. Is that the cross should ring in our hearts and in our minds. 1 Corinthians 1, you don't have to turn there, verse 18, Paul says, "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate. Where is the wise man? Where is the scholar? Where is the philosopher of this age?" You know, the thing about the message of the cross, as Paul talks about, it's not a message for the wise in mind. It's, you know, one man once said, the greatest distance to travel is 6 inches. It's the difference, it's the distance between our minds and our hearts. And the message for those that are wise and are trying to figure it out up here, don't get it. It's a message we have to get here, guys. Are we with me on that? Today, I hope that the Spirit will really guide us and steer us in that way. John the Baptist in John chapter 1:29, he says, he saw Jesus and he said, "Look, the Lamb of God who came to take the sins of the world away." He saw that, you know, it does depict Old Testament sacrifices. Leviticus 4 talks about a lamb being sacrificed for the sins of individuals. And we are those individuals. Hold your finger there in Matthew. Turn over me to Romans chapter 3. I think to understand the cross in the beginning is to understand what we gain in Jesus dying on the cross.
Yeah. Yes.
I think it's something that we've learned from some of us since we've been, you know, children. We go, man, yes, Jesus died on the cross. But what does that mean for us? In Romans 3, 21, you know, Paul spends the first two chapters really saying, man, God's wrath is coming. That it is coming for all of us. Man, the religious and those pagans, it's coming for us all. And we need to watch out. And there's only one hope for us. And this wrath is coming. And we see that in our day and age now, don't we?
Yeah.
Is that, man, it is obvious that we are in the end of times. Man, so things are going on that's blowing our minds.
Yes.
Paul says this is the benefit in Romans 3:21. "But now a righteousness from God, apart from law, has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented him as a sacrifice of atonement through faith in his blood. He did this to demonstrate his justice, because in his forbearance, he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate his justice at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. Where then is boasting? It is excluded. On what principle? On that of observing the law? No, but on that of faith." We'll stop right there. You know, Jesus dying on the cross has opened up this great door for us that we can have an be the righteousness of God. That we can be like God in that way. Someone once said that, righteousness is actually the same Greek word for justified or justification. And justified often has been said to mean just as if I've never sinned. And how sweet is that?
Yeah.
But Jesus offers not so much more than that.
Yeah.
And he gives us his spirit in our death, that we are empowered.
Oh. Right.
That we are right with God. He talks about how we are redeemed. He redeems us, Jesus. This redemption, this idea of buying back a slave so that he can be free. The question we ask ourselves is, what enslaves us? What enslaves you? Man, Jesus provides freedom for us. Man, we are no longer a slave to the world or even the sins of the world. He sets us free. How exciting is that? He atones us, makes amends, atonement at one minute. It's perfect unity, reconciliation with God.
Yeah.
United with him in every way. Jesus does all this.
Right.
It's not about what we do.
Right.
It's his work. It's his actions. Paul says, there is no room for boasting. Not about what I did. Or he says, boasting is removed. Because Jesus has done it all in the cross. How sweet is that, guys?
Yeah.
Does that fire you up?
Amen.
Unity with God, freedom, right with God, man, that he's washing us in every way and pouring on us so much more. Grace is gone. Guilt is gone. And he does it. No room for boasting. I love this picture here. You know, when I sit down and talk about the cross, I generally draw a big mountain, put someone at the top and someone in the valley. Says, you know, the person at the top, if you think about Mount Everest, the person from the top looks at the person in the valley, can't see them, 5 miles long. Man, this guy's way down there in the dumps, and I'm up here on the mountain in all my glory. But when that person on top of the mountain looks to the stars, he still falls incredibly short. Short from the glory of God. And the only way to get to God is through Christ.
Amen.
He is the ladder to the Lord. Amen? A really long ladder, by the way. Man, we get this in Jesus. And so what's our one point for us today is that Jesus is willingly died for all men. Willingly died for all men. Let's look at our text where this journey in some ways began in the Garden of Gethsemane. Matthew 26, look at it in verse 36.
All right, Tony.
The text says, then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, sit here while I go over there and pray. He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Going a little further, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. Could you men not keep watch with me for 1 hour? He asked Peter. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak. He went away a second time and prayed, my Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done. When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said, are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour is near, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With them was a large crowd armed with swords and clubs sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him. Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus replied, "Friend, do what you came for." Then the men stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrested him. With that, one of Jesus' companions reached for his sword, drew it out, and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. "Put your sword back in its place," Jesus said to him. "For all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Do you think I cannot call on my Father, and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? But how then will the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen in this way?" At that time, Jesus said to the crowd, "Am I leading a rebellion that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I sat in the temple courts, teaching, and you did not arrest me. But this has all taken place that the writings of the prophets might be fulfilled." Then all the disciples deserted him and fled. So here's where it all kind of begins, in the Garden of Gethsemane. And a couple years, actually, Tasha and I got a chance to go to the Garden of Gethsemane. Oh my goodness, and there is literally lines of people. You got to set an appointment, lines of people waiting to get in. You know, we got in there, it's like, okay, we got 25 minutes. Okay, we heard a little Devo, man. And it's moving that, man, this is where Jesus was praying for my soul.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, he had his Devo, and then it was like everybody scattered, okay? You got some time to go pray, man. People finding trees and just on your knees and crying out. And really, you know, for me, it was a time that I just thanked God. And thank you. You know, for praying for me. And it wasn't a dry eye in the house. And then everybody's picking up stuff and putting it in their pocket. Rocks from the Garden of Gethsemane. I wonder what it looked like, you know, even 200 years ago. So much war. A lot less rocks. But, you know, here, there are many people around the cross. Will did a great job with the communion today, really talking to us about, man, the physical pain that Jesus went through. Yeah. I want to talk a little bit about the emotional pain that he went through. And I think with that is that, man, Jesus loved everyone. And we see many different faces. And here in the garden, here we see Jesus praying. And Matthew says that he was sorrowful and troubled, and even Jesus says, man, I am troubled to the point of death. I think that's what someone who's committing suicide feels. Okay? It's like, man, it's too much. It is overwhelming. I can't do this. It would be better not to be here. Okay? Man, that's a lot of sorrow. And I think we lose sight that Jesus was a man, that he did have emotions, that he did have feelings. Wow. And here he is, anxious, if you will. You know, I find that I feel more anxious as I get older. Yep. Or maybe it's because my kids get older, I get more anxious. some of those older kids understand that.
Yeah. Yep.
But, you know, what did Jesus do in this overwhelmed? He prayed.
Amen.
You know, and how much we should be praying. You know, what's your prayer life like? Yeah. Anxiety is a great catalyst for us to remind us that we need to pray.
Yeah.
But Jesus, in this prayer, he is actually praying, "God, take this cup away." So many people think Jesus hopped up on the cross. Hey, yeah, I'm here, no problem. Man, he did not want to do it.
All right.
But he was a poster picture of what denial really looks like. He's like, "Oh God, I don't want to do this, but I'm going to do what you want me to do. But if it's all possible, take it away." That's what I would like. I think our prayers need to be like that. I think often we have ideas and things that we want to do, and we go to prayer, God, I think this is awesome, and I feel like this is going to be best for me, and I want you to make it work. Amen. Versus really wrestling. We see him wrestling with his heart here. And what does he do? He brings his close friends, James, John, Peter. He gets help in this time. He's humble. Hey, I need your help. Stay with me. Watch with me. Pray with me. He's vulnerable about where he's at. Not independent at all. And what do? They fall asleep. Hey, guys, wake up. Pray that you're not tempted. I'm praying for you, but you should be praying for yourself, too. Even in that motivation. It goes off, and what do they do? Fall asleep. They fall asleep 3 times. I think Jesus would have felt so alone.
Right.
So abandoned by his best friends. Hey, guys, I need you right now. They're not there. How that would have hurt Jesus in a great way. We also see that Jesus, as he gets ready for this challenge, God has changed his heart, right? Here comes my betrayer! Rise! Come on! Exclamation point. Look at the text there. He's like, man, he's ready! And as soon as he's out to go, here comes Judas. I think something we got to remember is that Jesus died for the betrayer.
Right.
He dies for all men willingly, but he died for the betrayal. How many of us have faced the hardship of betrayal? Yeah. And someone has stabbed us in the back, right?
Yeah.
Betrayal. It's this. What makes betrayal so cutting, if you will, is the deceit that's behind it. Right? See, man, it's the handshake. Hey, man, I'm with you, but man, the knife behind the back and looking for the opportunity. That's what Judas was.
Yeah.
All along, he knew, man, I have my price and I'm going to betray. Here, Jesus was intimate with Jesus. Jesus was intimate with Judas in the Passover time. And John 13 talks about how he's washing the feet of his disciples. Mm-hmm. And even at that time, he's telling them, hey, one of them is going to betray me. He's washing Judas's feet. It's to the point where everyone's looking around and saying, who is it? Jesus' love for Judas was so great. Nobody else could detect it.
Right.
Nobody else knew. Man, who is it? It could be one of my boss. I know if I was Jesus, Judas would be off to the side in the corner. I'd be avoiding him, right? Where are your feet been? And he lets him approach him, knowing. He lets him kiss him, and then Jesus calls him friend.
Wow.
He died for the betrayal. You know, how have you betrayed Jesus?
Talk about it.
From all the time.
I think we do it in many different ways. It is deceit, right?
Yeah.
It starts with deceit. Sometimes I think we deceive ourselves to our commitment to Jesus.
Wow.
And yeah, I'm committed, but we know we're not where we need to be. It's this pretending to have it all together. You know, we come in, we're worshiping, we're loving Jesus, yes. But behind the scenes, when no one is watching, except for Jesus, we're not living the way that he wants us to live.
Come on.
I think betrayal is that we use, right? Isn't that what betrayal is all about? It's like, I'm using you to get what I want. And I think if we're not careful, we can use Jesus.
Come on.
We use him for healings. When we're sick, oh, praise him, help me, get me through. When our finances are tough, man, our quiet times are, man, we are in there. We need that job. We're texting people and asking people, bro, please pray for me.
Wow.
Even in gaming and desiring. desiring different relationships. Oh, man, we can use Jesus. We can betray Jesus. And Jesus willingly embraces the betrayer. You see the story of Pilate. As you move over to chapter 27, beginning in verse 11, we see Pilate, and he's the governor looking over this Palestine area at this time, and yet his boss is the emperor, and he's kind of caught between a rock and a hard place here. He's trying to keep peace here with the Jewish people, and yet make sure that his boss is happy. And yet, I think his conscience is working on him at different times as well. And then, even in this whole finagle of things, he realizes that Jesus is innocent. He's a bit like a politician. Being so close to D.C., I'm sure we rub our shoulders up against people like that. But he had the ability to set Jesus free. He knew he was innocent. He knew the Jewish people were envious of him.
That's right.
We too have that ability to set Jesus free.
Right, come on.
But Pilate was more considered about focused on what other people thought instead of focusing on what God thought. Imagine if it was written differently. Man, Pilate could be the hero.
Yeah.
The scriptures in many ways. Not really the hero, Jesus is the hero. But man, at this point in time, man, okay, he's innocent. I will not have him be crucified. Well, we're going to crucify you then, my friend. Well, man, bring it on, and amen. But instead, he pleases the people.
Yeah.
And sometimes we can find ourselves in that situation. We're too worried about what people think.
Come on.
Instead of worrying about what God thinks.
Amen.
We can too much wrestle with what the world may think about us or say about us. Versus, what does God think? I think even in our worship, we can be like that.
Yeah.
Even amongst one another, we can be like that. We may get the urge to throw a hand up and say, hallelujah, but kind of concerned what the person right next to us might think if they see me throwing up my hand. Are we with me on that?
Come on.
Some of us are smiling.
Mm-hmm.
We get that. We can. We got to focus on Christ.
Amen.
Jesus died for the people pleaser too. I love Barabbas. Barabbas, a notorious prisoner, a murderer. And Pilate, in trying to deal with this, says, hey, I'll bring out Barabbas. Who would you rather me set free? This murderer back to the community? Or Jesus, who I've seen nothing wrong, back into the community? And the people cry out, crucify Jesus. Give us Barabbas. How do you think Barabbas would have felt being set free? I'd like to think, man, I've got a second chance. I can start all over. I can actually do something right in the community. Or maybe he just goes back to his old ways.
Yep.
We really don't know. But he's given a choice. You know, his name actually means Bar Abba or Bar Abbas. It means son of a father. And I think that Barabbas could be any of us. Barabbas is actually every one of us.
Yep.
And that we are all faced with a choice.
Yeah.
I think the greatest thing about Barabbas is it's clear that Jesus took his place on the cross. That he would have been set free, and I think would leave thinking, really?
Can I get to it?
All right.
And realizing and calculating what he's done, who he's murdered and killed, and yet he goes free.
Right.
Wow. You took personal, we've got to take personal responsibility.
Yeah.
You know, we had a young lady that's currently studying the Bible in Richmond. We've got actually quite a few married couples that are studying, which is so exciting. Please pray for us to be able to see married couples get baptized. It's
awesome.
Whoa.
You know, the guy gets baptized, boom, amen, and then he turns around and baptizes his wife. It's so exciting. And this young lady's name is Ayana. And Ayana studied the cross last week, and after hearing the message of the cross, she just started texting people. Man, did you know that Jesus did this? And she, the study finished like 11 at night. So she's texting people. She called a few people. And then just, text the sister back. Man, I'm so excited. This is great. Do people really know this message? And I think, man, she got it.
Amen.
She's like, man, I did this. To the point where she's talking about it. Look, I got to tell somebody tonight. Her husband works late. He came home at late, and he was giving her an earful about Jesus. And he hadn't started studying the cross yet, and so he called up the brothers and said, hey, listen, when are we going to study the cross? You know, I want to hear about this message, too. And they're taking it personally. You know, we murdered Jesus. And Jesus willingly dies for he who murders as well.
Right.
I'm reminded of the soldiers who later in chapter 27, they mock this innocent Jesus. They know what they're doing is wrong, but they're doing it anyway. There's been some discoveries of even in Jerusalem, markings that have been found on the ground that actually model kind of a board game. And that Jesus was actually in the mocking, when the scriptures talked about people casting lots, others say throwing dice, that actually this game is about dressing up a king in burlesque outfits, okay? And getting him to, kind of roll around the area. And in many ways, Jesus was a game piece in these soldiers' game. They knew their behavior was wrong, but they did it anyway, right? And I think that we are just like those soldiers. When we do what's wrong, and we know it's wrong, and yet we do it anyway. I think it's this time that we begin playing games with Christ.
Wow.
I remember when I first started studying the Bible, years ago, and I knew that I was a Barabbas, but I also knew, man, I can't pretend. I want to. And the more that I began to study the Bible, the more I realized, man, I've got to be honest with so many of the things that are going on in my life. And I had went to Howard University.
Did you?
Oh, we got some people representing that.
Never wait.
Been so long. But I remember being in college and blowing it in my grades, and being asked to sit out a semester of college.
Wow.
You know, what do they call it? Academic probation, AP, right? Oh my goodness, I'm here. Didn't tell my parents. Right? I'm like, I'm loving DC. I ain't telling nobody. Didn't tell my friends, because I was so embarrassed. Man, what am I doing? So live this lie, took money from my parents, $5,000. That's what college could buy 20 years ago, $5,000.
Wow.
Yeah, that's good money, right?
Yep.
Put it in the bank, was deceitful in that whole, transaction. And as I'm studying the Bible on campus, I'm studying around my schedule, my classes. Yeah.
Oh, Tony.
And they're like, so when can you study next? Can you study at 12 tomorrow? No, I got a class. But I can study at 1. So, here I'm studying, but in my heart I'm like, can't play. I can't pretend. I stopped studying. I studied again and thought, okay, I gotta get my act together here. And just the challenge to try to be open with my life. Okay, guys, this is really what's been happening. Praise God, God changed my heart. Gave me the ability. I remember seeing people study the cross. You know, they were teaching it in church and thinking, man, seeing all the Christians' hearts, you know, cut and convicted and thinking, man, I want that.
Yeah.
I want my heart to be that way, God. Help me in that area. God did. Praise God.
Amen.
I appreciate Jesus. Jesus' willingness to die for the Barabbases, for the mockers. How should we respond to that? That's a good question. Romans 5 says this. You can read along or you can turn there. Paul says, you see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for the righteous man, though for a good man, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. You know, we are those people around the cross. When you pick out who you are, Barabbas, Judas, or, you know, even the disciples in the garden, whoever you may be, man, you are unworthy to die for. We are all unworthy to die for.
Yeah.
And yet Jesus was willing to do that.
Amen.
Not just do it, but fight to do
right.
it.
Right.
You know, wrestle to deal with the abandonment and the hurt and the pain, the backstabbing, the mocking, and to embrace all that. And to work on his heart. So that we could have life. He
wow.
willingly died
Amen.
For us. How do you respond to that? I think gratitude, right?
Yeah.
Oh, thank you! I am a wretch, but you are loving. Amen! We should be actually excited.
Yeah.
Our heart should be moved. We should be touched. We should be grateful. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Amen.
See, when we have that heart, when we accept the gift, I think, man, he is so gracious. When we accept that, then our heart willingly responds.
Yeah.
It's not about what do I have to do. It's about getting grateful, thankful.
Yeah.
And guess what happens? Then you're willing to do whatever.
Right.
Amen.
It's serving. It's having this grateful heart. Amen. I love it's so wonderful. Anybody watch Shark Tank?
Yeah.
I've learned about Mr. Wonderful, who's not very wonderful. But one of the things that I've noticed about him is when he gets fed up with something, when he doesn't understand someone's logic, or their thinking or perspective, when he's fed up with how someone is doing their own business or doing business, he simply says, "You're dead to me." And he just shuts it down, right? You're dead to me! Right in the middle of a conversation or something, well, you know, it's kind of like you're trying to figure, you're dead to me! And I think this should be our response to the cross. That our worldly thinking, that our worldly behavior, that things in the world, you're dead to me! That we cut it out! We shut it off! Because the cross means so much to us.
Amen.
We're like, oh man, I love Jesus so much. Someone comes into your dorm room with beer or whatever, you're dead to me! Get out of here! Come on, bro. That when some woman or guy is flirting you with you at work, you're dead to me! When Satan is tempting you, he says you're not good enough, or you can't do it, or you're just like you were 10 years ago, 5 years ago, last week, you're dead to me! Peter says it best in closing.
Amen.
Here's the guy who was there. He was one of the ones that Jesus was in the garden with Jesus, right? Betrays him. He's one of the ones that fled. He says it best in chapter 2, 1 Peter, verse 21. To this you were called because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his footsteps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, amen, so that we might, dead to me, die to sin, and live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. You know, here's the guy who was there. He gets it. He passes it to us. Man, may we get it today. Man, Jesus died for me. May we own it. May we relish in it. May we be so grateful. May it inspire us, man, to live righteous lives as best as we can. Live being led by the Spirit. We say no to the world and anyone who's got worldly thinking. Man, let's live like that at the Tobin Valley. If this message is new to you today, hey, grab the person who invited you. Say, hey, listen, I want to know more about this. Man, I just kind of skimmed across the whole lot. There's so much more about the cross that can help us to appreciate Jesus all the more. Man, you're visiting, grab that person and say, man, I want to know more about studying the Bible. I want to know more about these things. If you remember here, hey, let's keep living that way in Potomac Valley. Man, you guys are setting great examples. We hear about you in Richmond. We're inspired about what you're doing here and how God is using you. Thank you so much. Keep doing what you're doing. Amen?
Amen. Amen.